Good morning. Everybody say good morning to those that are watching.
Good morning.
Yeah. We're glad to have you here this morning. We're going to be talking about the message title this morning is The Just Shall Live by Faith. And if you don't know by now, you can download the notes, print them out, and follow along with us. I've always been doing this since we started with kind of a Bible study when this first started, that I've just kind of continued. And one reason I do this is that I try to stay with one page. It kind of locks me into not going more than 4 hours. Everybody okay with that?
Yeah.
All right. I thought this was kind of cute. Michael sent this to me. It was a Mark Twain quote this week. It says, Heaven goes by favor. If it went by merit, you would stay out and your dog would go in. I thought that's pretty true. But thank God it's not by merit.
Amen.
We're going to do, this sort of goes along with the chapter in the book about imparted faith, because I think this is an important aspect of what I've come out of, which really started out in a more of a full gospel Pentecostal church, then going to a Word of Faith. In the Word of Faith church, I feel like there was a confusion about faith. The faith was always being presented as if it was my faith,
yeah.
And so it caused me a lot of personal discouragement. And I believe it's caused the church a lot of personal discouragement. So I think if we can understand what faith really is and how it operates, I think it'll take that load off of us that we've been carrying around. Because I used to, you know, faith is a spiritual aspect of things. It comes from a spiritual standpoint. It comes from the spirit. It's not a natural thing. It's not mind control. It's not trying to make something happen because of willpower. Something like that, which is kind of the way it was presented, the Word of Faith.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And when you didn't feel successful with it, mm-hmm. you always felt like, well, but I don't have, my faith is just not very
yeah.
good.
Right.
Yeah.
But it wasn't supposed to be our faith to start with.
Amen.
Right.
And that's what I want to clarify, because this is the foundation, I believe, as we go through this book and some of the truths that we already have. A lot of these are just going to be confirmations, and that's what it blessed me, is because we've been teaching this for 10 years now. But I think it'll really confirm, because he has such a good way of articulating these truths. I think it'll really confirm in your heart some things, because between now and the end of the year, I'm hoping that the families that aren't here, I hope that we can get on page with this, and because I think he wants us to be established.
Yes.
Not, you know, we've all awakened to righteousness. We went through an awakening of righteousness. And that's what causes, it's awake to righteousness and sin not. The sinning issue is dealt with by understanding our righteousness.
Yes.
Amen. And so, but that, I don't want to just be awake to it. I want to be established in that righteousness.
Amen.
And I believe that's what he wants us to do, as far as coming to the unity of the faith, that we would all come to that same understanding and knowledge, so that we can be edified. Sometimes, you ever felt like you were in a mosh pit?
Yeah.
I've never been in one, but I've seen a lot of people getting bumped around out in there and mm-hmm. floating around on top of each other and all that. And sometimes you feel like when I was in this, you always feel like you were getting beat up at every turn. It was always something that was causing you to feel bad. And we're not supposed to feel that way. We're supposed to understand what this faith is. And as I was studying this, and of course, this is open. If someone feels like they have something, a comment from the Lord to give more edification, don't feel like I'm just up here to be the only one talking. You can speak out. Just let me see your hand and we'll acknowledge that. But first of all, I just discovered, actually this morning, I woke up about 5 o'clock and these things start going through my heart. But faith actually is not only, it's a gift of the Spirit, it's one of the gifts of the Spirit if you look in 1 Corinthians. But if you go over to Ephesians, it's one of the fruit of the Spirit. Isn't that amazing? Faith is a gift and it's a fruit. So what is a fruit? What does it mean when it's a fruit? That means it comes out of who we are, right? It's His Spirit in us. So I just think that's an interesting thing to realize right up front, is that this is this is a gift, and it's a, and it should be a fruit, and not, it shouldn't be something that we're trying to strive to have on our own. Amen. So let's look at this. You don't have to look at Habakkuk. I just put the verse in there. Habakkuk's a little prophet, a little mini. It's hard to actually hard to find it in the Old Testament if you don't know where it is. But it says, he says, "Behold the proud. His soul is not upright in him." Anybody that's that understands the where pride came from, where did it come from? The enemy. Satan. He was the first proud person. He has lifted himself up. But the tree of knowledge that they were told not to eat from in the garden, it resulted in them eating. It resulted in us having either pride or condemnation. Those are the only two options we have from the tree of knowledge. And the one that's the most deceptive is the pride. Because we think that we have, if we have a success in what we're doing, spiritually or whatever, then it's because of my what I'm doing. And that's what he's saying here. In fact, I could talk the whole hour on this, the first section of the notes here. His soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Now, I think that's an interesting point. We'll see here in just a minute because we're going to go to Romans. Now, I put in the parentheses there a scripture in Luke chapter 18, verses 9 through 14. We actually touched on this a little bit Thursday night. But this is where Jesus talks about the parable of the two people that went and prayed in the temple. One of them was a Pharisee, the other was a tax collector. What did the Pharisee do? He stood over and says, "Well, I'm glad I'm not like that guy. Proud, he's boasting and everything. I'm a faster, I'm a tither, I've done this, I've done that." See, his soul was not upright in him. But then the other guy was over there saying, not even looking up, he said, "Lord, have mercy on me." He went to the throne of grace and he obtained mercy. And it said, what did Jesus say about that man? When he left there, he went away
justified.
What does that mean?
Righteous.
Declared righteous. Amen. Not by his work, but by the mercy he asked for. Amen. That was based on Jesus' work. And that's why I put that. You can go back and look at those verses. That's one of my favorite parables in Scripture, because it's not just really just a parable. He meets the two people in the next few parts of chapter of Luke 18 and 19. Now go to Romans real quick. Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, starting in verse 16, says, "For I'm not ashamed of a gospel."
Jesus.
Okay, see, I love that. See, I do, for those that haven't been here very often, I say words. I used to do this with my kids when I'd read a storybook when they were little. I'd say the wrong word and they'd always correct me. I'm doing the same thing because I want to make sure that you're listening to me and that you're following along.
You're awake.
You're awake, absolutely. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel. There's only one, and it's based upon the finished work of Christ. For it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. And what was the difference in the way Paul wrote it versus Habakkuk? What did he leave out?
His.
He just puts faith in there. Because now he has a recognition of what faith really is. And I believe that's the distinction that Paul was trying to make here. When we hear the word faith, and I'm doing some of this week based upon, Deborah said, maybe I wasn't quite as clear as I should have been 2 weeks ago about this, because it's such a new thing for us to think about, because we were so programmed in the wrong way of using our faith. And so it takes a little while. It's kind of a cow looking at a new gate sometimes. It's, or a dog at a new pan. You know, kind of like, you know. So I want to make it I want to make it a little clearer this morning. So just follow along with me. If you don't understand it, we'll get there. Okay? When we hear the word faith, what phrase might be good to remember? What might be a good phrase?
A conviction of the truth.
It is a conviction of the truth, but I put down, and I think this is, we can give you the long version that has that in it, but what Jesus did.
Amen.
Faith, the word faith should kind of bring to our mind what Jesus did.
Amen.
Okay, on the other side of the coin, what, and Tom was verifying that out of Romans, what about when we hear the words law or works? What I do. So faith, in reality, faith is a conviction of the truth concerning what Jesus did. That's the substance of it. It's never used in Scripture as a verb. It's always a noun. It's always a reality. Jesus' finished work is the biggest and greatest reality that's ever been, what he accomplished. And so, but it's about what Jesus did. So when we hear the word faith, you're going to see this in some of the spaces along the way here in the notes, but our mind should go what Jesus did. Because see, in the past, faith was, okay, what can I try to believe? I don't have to try to believe in anything except what Jesus did. Because that's where the power is. That's where the righteousness is. That's where Jesus has been and made unto us wisdom. And I think wisdom's there first because wisdom is, it's about Jesus. Wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. So that he that boasts, let him boast in the Lord. So he's been made unto us all those things. So faith should be really a conviction of that truth about him. Yes?
And after hearing this word, that Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith, now suddenly that makes sense. You know,
Mark said that very thing Thursday night.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. Right, Jesus is.
But what does it say just before that? In that verse, looking unto Jesus.
The author
and finisher of our faith.
Okay.
So that's,
what's the reference?
In fact, the word our, we saw that 2 weeks ago, it just has faith there. Yeah. The author and finisher of faith. So this blesses me because, see, what the Holy Spirit's trying to do, he did it Thursday night. It was really a good meeting. You know, Thursday night was really an awesome meeting. There were six of us there, and it was just all about Jesus. You know, it was great. So what Donna said, and Mark, see, he's bringing this truth together through the mouth of two or three witnesses. It's not about me standing up here trying to tell you what to think or what to believe. The Holy Spirit wants you to understand this truth. Amen? Did you have something?
No, I was just going to say that one of the translations I looked at said that he was the source and the goal.
That's good. The source and the goal.
And the goal.
Yeah, he's the goal. And he's already finished. He's already been to the goal line. And we've just been running behind him. He scored the ultimate touchdown.
That's right.
He put his hands out like this and said, it's finished, right? His hands may have been more like this. You know. Touchdown. Yeah, he finished the work. So that's what I wanted you to. It's a conviction of the truth concerning what Jesus did. So I want to tie together just for a minute here, based upon in the second section of your notes there, it talks about in 1 Corinthians 15:34. You don't have to turn there, otherwise we may miss our lunch today. But it says awake to righteousness and do not sin. So I believe this body. We're maturing in this truth, the word of truth about the gospel, which is the gospel is what? The good news of salvation through Christ. That's the gospel. It's not through us anymore. It's through him. Amen. And so we've awakened to that. It was a wonderful awakening to me to know it was not, to find out it wasn't about me.
Wow.
Because religion is about us.
Right.
Performance. What we do. Mount Sinai, they were at the bottom with no hope of being able to climb up because you couldn't even touch the mountain and get stoned. Where are we now? We're seated. We have come, according to Hebrews, we have come to Mount Zion.
Amen.
We're seated at the top. And there's nowhere to go from there except down.
Yeah.
What a difference. We've arrived in Christ. We're seated with him in heavenly places in Christ. Amen. That's awesome news.
Amen.
So what I want you to see about this is, in Isaiah 54, you can turn there real quick, Isaiah 54. Y'all mind if I go a little fast with the scripture turning? Trisha did like 400 scriptures in 45 minutes. I don't know how she does it, but she makes it all clear for every single verse.
Talks fast for a
Southerner. Yeah, for somebody from Alabama, she talks pretty good. In fact, she is in Jeremiah's church this morning. Yeah. Trisha is in Kentucky in Jeremiah Johnson's church. Mm-hmm. Deborah and I were asking Trisha to come speak, and Jeremiah was standing there with us, and he said, "Oh, don't worry, don't bother. She's not going. I've been trying to get her for 3 years to come."
Oh.
So he said, she's not going to come. She's not going to come to you, Chuck. I've been trying to get her. And so I just told him, I said, well, we got her to come here first.
Yeah.
If they're watching, sorry about that. We'll talk more about that when he gets here next time. But it says in Isaiah chapter 54, which follows what chapter?
53.
See, this is a sharp group. But Isaiah 53 is about the crucifixion of Jesus. It's all about what Jesus went through for us. He bore all of our sicknesses and all of that, and we're supposed to believe their report. So when you come into that place of being a believer and you get to Isaiah 54, then it says there in verse 14, in righteousness you shall be established. In righteousness, whose righteousness? What you do?
No.
Or what he did?
His
righteousness. It's imputed to you. And it says, you shall be far from oppression. This is what Deborah and several other people were prophesying this morning. And it fits right in. It always does. People bring these things up and they all fit right in with what we're going to talk about. Why are we far from oppression?
Because
it's about what he did. Oppression comes to us when the enemy can lie to us and make us think it's about us.
Yep.
See, that's when the oppression comes in. If we can remove and remove that rejection, remove that that lie, that idea that it's about us,
accusations,
all those things, and that oppression will begin to cease as we become established in the fact that we are the righteous of God in Christ.
Amen.
I don't have anything to prove to anybody.
Amen.
He proved it for me, as me.
Amen.
In redemption. He did the proving for me, not for himself.
Amen.
And he's given that to us as a gift. And that's why I'm putting this in here about the righteous, because I think that is so important as a foundation of faith. So I put that in the second section for that. So when it's about our goodness, oppression comes. When it's about his goodness, oppression begins to cease.
Amen.
It's not about how good we are. In fact, I like that phrase. I think Joseph Prince has said it about the Holy Spirit's here to tell us what's right with us in spite of what's wrong with us because of Jesus.
Amen.
So in spite of what's wrong with us, the Holy Spirit's here to tell us what's right about us.
Amen.
Because of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Because the Holy Spirit, he witnessed what Jesus did at the cross.
Absolutely. He was the witness.
He was the witness to tell us what he did.
Absolutely. Nobody, anybody other, any other eyewitnesses here? So the one that matters is the one that's inside you right now that's witnessing that truth.
Amen.
So then it says, and why is God just in declaring us righteous? Why is he just in doing that? According to the verse I put in the parentheses there, 2 Corinthians 5:21 says what? He who knew no sin became so that we might become the righteous of God. He changed, exchanged with our sin and given. He took our sin and gave us his righteousness.
Amen.
Isn't that an awesome deal?
Amen.
What an awesome deal. What an awesome God.
Amen.
What an awesome plan of redemption for us.
Amen.
And I just declare oppression is going to cease. As we come into this, as we're established in this righteousness, through the rest of this year, I want us to be really become that city on a hill. That, you know, we're not through with John yet. We're just getting started with John. Not John.
My wife says the same thing.
Yeah. but we're going to get back to John. But I felt like this was what we needed to do today. So he's just in declaring us righteous. So just means he's declared us righteous. That's the same thing as that man praying in the temple who happened to be Zacchaeus. And Zacchaeus' name means pure one.
Pure one.
So he was pure, not because of what he did, but because of his faith in asking for mercy and receiving the righteousness that was given to him as a gift.
Amen.
Which one's behavior changed, the rich young ruler or Zacchaeus?
Zacchaeus.
Because the change comes by right believing, not by right doing.
Amen.
Amen? Okay. Romans, in the third section of your notes there, therefore having been justified, now that means declared righteous, that goes in that blank. If you're justified, you're declared righteous. You're not justified by what your deeds are, good or bad. And I'm telling you, The good ones are the most deceptive, because it'll make you feel like you should be justified because after all, I'm doing this, 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 and this, and I'm not doing this, 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 and this.
So that's the older brother syndrome.
The older brother syndrome, that's a good way of putting it. OBS. That's a new we will come up with. Older brother syndrome. OBS. Where we start, it's like IBS. But it's...
You know, with Zacchaeus, you really saw the true transformation happen when Jesus, you know, he's like, I'm coming to your house today. It's like, because during that time, tax collectors are like the most outcast of the entire population.
In that time?
They're even worse than prostitutes, you know, that, yeah, in the eyes of their own people. And
yeah,
for Jesus to go in there and he's like,
hey,
I got to come to your house.
Well, he said, get out of that tree. Get out of that tree. See, faith takes a... We want mountain-moving faith. Or Jesus used two illustrations. Remove a tree and remove a mountain. It's the Mount Sinai that needs to be removed.
Yes, a lot.
And it's the tree of knowledge that needs to be pulled up and cast into the sea, right? That's what he was really talking about. And that's faith. That's what faith is all about.
Acceptance. That acceptance and love that, you know, it's like, wow, if Jesus wants to come to my house, like, nobody comes to my house.
Exactly. So oppression began to cease in his house when Jesus came in. And it says, and it was a play on words. It says, salvation is coming to your house, because the word salvation in Hebrew is Yeshua.
And it's the goodness of God that leads you to repentance.
Absolutely. It's his goodness, yeah. But, that story about Gabriel coming to Mary and, you know, naming the child Jesus. We don't use the word Jesus, but what his name was, it said, I want you to call his name salvation.
Amen.
So even when he was a kid, here comes salvation. I don't know why they named him salvation, but he's coming right there. But sooner or later, he lived up to that name, right? He didn't live up to it. Sometimes we put the word Jesus in there. It takes on a different meaning when he was named salvation. That was his name, was salvation.
So salvation is a person, not a prayer.
Absolutely.
Amen.
That's right. Good word. That's a good word, Mark.
Amen.
Good word. But doesn't it sound different when you read the story about Gabriel now? We're coming up to Christmas. It says, you know, his name will be Jesus, which is his name will be salvation, before he will save his people from their sins. And he's Emmanuel, God with us. Therefore, having been justified by faith, again, what do you put in the blank? See, we're justified by what Jesus did, right?
Amen.
By our faith, there is
faith. Well, the word in the third section of your notes where it says, therefore, having been justified by faith, you put in the parentheses, when you hear the word faith, what do you all mean? What I'm trying to get your ear to kind of go to.
What
Jesus did.
Justified by his faith.
Yeah, what he did.
Right.
Yeah, what he accomplished.
What he has finished for us.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So that's what I'm, through the notes here, we're trying to get you to think what Jesus did every time you hear the word faith.
Yeah.
It's what Jesus did.
Amen. Or almost every time we could go through the scripture, just say the faith of Christ or the faith of God. Or
absolutely.
Faith.
Yeah, and that's the substance. That's what the substance of faith is.
Amen.
And that's why it has that hope that everybody was prophesying. Because it's not based upon us deserving it or living up to anything, or it's because he wants to give it to you, Crystal. Is that right? I love Crystal being here with us because she didn't get trained wrong and had to unlearn so much. She came in and just learned the word of his grace.
Amen.
And so what a blessing that would have been. But nevertheless, we come through things to, if nothing else, to make us realize how much more a blessing it is to when we get delivered from all that religious stuff.
Yeah.
Amen? Into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Ephesians chapter 2. I love this one. It's in your notes, fourth section of your notes. Ephesians 2, verse 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith. What's in the blank?
What Jesus did.
You're saved by what Jesus did.
It's funny thing is we got it switched around, so we always thought our faith produces grace.
Absolutely.
It's grace that produces.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Absolutely. Yeah. I love that lyric on there where it says faith and grace align.
Yeah.
That's what this alignment is coming about, faith, is it's aligning with what grace is. But what I want you to see in this, For by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. So what is that, and that not of yourselves referring to?
Faith.
It's faith and grace. So that faith is not of yourself. That's the part I want you to see there. That faith is not of yourself. It's a gift. If you understand the gospel, if you understand the truth, the revelation of Jesus Christ, it's been gifted to you by hearing about Jesus in your heart by the power of the Holy Spirit. He begins to author that, what he did in your heart, that starts and establishes. And that's why he said you only need a mustard seed of that. Because the mustard seed of what Jesus did, it says to him that's given, more shall be added until you have. But him that does not have, what he has will be taken away. And that's what has been taken away from me, all that religion. But what he produced in my heart through his faith, gifting that, authoring that faith in me, the more I, that little bit, is like he said, he put it in a loaf and it leavens the whole lump. That's leavening us. That's bringing us to the realization through everything. It's all about him. But he's the author. And I wanted you to see that's not of yourselves. That faith is not of yourselves any more than the grace is. It's a gift.
That's so good.
It's a gift. Mm-hmm. Lest anyone should boast. And so it's not of works. Now what goes in the blank besides of works?
What I do.
It's not what I do. It's what he did.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And here's another, a confirming verse in Matthew chapter 16. It's in your notes. And what he's doing there, he's asking, everybody's trying to figure out, who is this guy? You know, who is, and so Jesus asked his disciples, who do men say that I am? And some of them say you're Elijah, some of them say, for good reason, and we're going to get to that. Some say John the Baptist, some say this and one. But then he says, but who do you say I am? He turns to Peter and says, who do you say that I am? And what does Peter say?
You're the Christ.
You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. But what does he say back to him? This is my favorite. He changes his name just in this one sense. He doesn't call him, hey, Peter. he says,
Simon Bar-Jonah.
Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah. What does that mean? Hearing by the dove.
Amen. Wow.
Simon Bar-Jonah means hearing by the dove. So what he's telling Matthew says, you're blessed. Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah. Blessed are you, Peter. Because you've heard this by the Spirit. This faith has been birthed in your heart about who I am. By the Spirit. Isn't that amazing that the wording is always put in there for a specific reason for that? Does everybody understand what I meant by that?
Yeah,
the hearing
yeah.
is by the dove. The dove is the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Amen.
Our hearing has to be in regard to faith, in regard to what Jesus did. It has to be. We have to, you know, faith is not a natural thing. Faith is a spiritual thing. It's imparted. It's not mustard.
Amen.
It's not mustard like on a sandwich. It's not mustard up. It's not mayonnaise either.
It's not a sandwich.
It's not even a sandwich.
So there's not a formula.
Yes, we increase our faith well one way, and y'all have already said it. So everybody always tells my sermon before I get a chance to go there,
Amen.
But that's okay because it's a confirmation. So the more we hear about Jesus, the more faith, what he does, grows, and that's that increase that comes by the Holy Spirit because he's only Jesus. I mean, the Holy Spirit's only going to tell you about the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of all prophecy, Old Testament included. It's all about him. It was all concealed, but it's been revealed in Christ. Emmaus Road was all about unveiling what all those stories really meant. And that causes your heart to get warm, doesn't it, Zach? It causes, when you realize that story about Moses holding up that serpent, it's about Jesus.
Amen.
You know, that's awesome. I love it when Michael starts smiling, because he's always smiling on the inside, but occasionally he starts smiling. When I start talking about Jesus, the more I talk about Jesus, the bigger he's smiling. So, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who's in heaven. Isn't that a wonderful thing? If you're sitting in here and you're a believer, it's because the Father in heaven has given you the gift to understand this truth.
Amen.
Amen.
What a thing. In fact, he said, you know, when they were casting out demons and doing all kinds of stuff, what did he say? Don't rejoice in that. Rejoice that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Amen.
That's the rejoicing part. It's all that stuff that, that I think is going to start happening, but and more so as we get on track here. Okay, now Romans chapter 10, verses 16 and 17. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. Oh boy, uh-oh. Obey the gospel. That sounds like something we need to do, right? What does it mean to obey the gospel?
To believe
it. Obedience in the new covenant, is to believe. And you can read Hebrews. It's all about that. It's all about coming into that rest. The reason they couldn't enter into the promised land is because they thought they had to do something. And all they had to do was walk in there and take it. And that's why Joshua, whose name also means, you know, it's Yeshua, was leading them in. It was the same leader. You know, it was, Moses couldn't take them in. The law could not. In fact, the 12 spies that went in the first time, 10 of them had to disappear before they sent the two back in the second time. Those 10 spies is the law. The law can't get you in the promised land.
Amen.
So they had to cease and desist and fade away before the Joshua said, "We're just sending these two this time. We're not going to try to get in there based on the 10 anymore.
Yeah.
We're just going with the two."
Real quick, like I guess maybe faith in the new covenant would be, obedience would be obedience of faith, mm-hmm. something like that. So it would be like coming under the influence of what God knows to be true about me.
Absolutely. That's the influence of that identity. That's where he's wanting us to go. Yeah, that's good. Mark is really in the, you know, he went to Rhema and learned some things like I did, some things the wrong way. Like the guy writing in the back of this book, he said, before he got this understanding, he let a lot of people into the ditch. That's his words, and I did too. There's a ditch on both sides of the road, legalism, and, but Mark is, Mark is really, he's got they have a fellowship on in Katy, and so we're glad to have him here this morning, and I believe that he's knitting our groups together for some purpose. We'll see where the Lord goes with that. But so then faith, I didn't put the blank in there for you this time, but so then what Jesus did comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of, really it should be Christ.
Amen.
It's the words, when you hear about Christ, then that faith comes.
Amen.
Yeah.
The faith, which again, it's about what Jesus did. But the more we hear about Jesus, the more his faith by the Holy Spirit that he's authored begins to grow.
Yeah.
When we start hearing about ourselves again, you can go to any church, so many churches this morning, and hear about what you need to be doing. And I believe the more we hear about, begin to continue to hear about who we are, then our doing out there will become more productive. Because if I'm here to hear about how I'm doing, I'm going to spend all week trying to correct that. So what do I have time for somebody else? I'm trying to make myself somehow squeak into heaven or get through that gap that you're talking about being in there.
You know, and it's not only like just hearing the words of Jesus, because so many churches just preach Jesus, but they preach it legalism, because the whole entire context of this is the righteousness of faith.
The righteousness of faith.
It's when you're hearing it's the righteousness of faith, that's faith comes in.
Yeah. And then, see, now it's Acts, y'all are just, everybody, this is just perfect timing, because that's the next one here. Let's go to this. I'm telling you, this doesn't happen by accident. Galatians chapter, this has become one of my favorite passages and you'll see for various reasons, Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Starting with verse 5. This is a question by the Apostle Paul to a very legalistic, performance-based church that had left the original message that he brought them to go back into a mixture. And I think Galatianism is the biggest problem in the church today.
Amen.
And this, if you read this, read it in the message, you'll laugh your head off all the way through this. Read the Galatians, the little letter to the Galatians in the Message translation. Once you know the gospel, the truth of the word of salvation, it's all through Christ and not of us.
Amen.
this Galatianism stands out to you. This Galatians will really begin to show you the contrast between being right on the mark and being in mixture of law and grace. But he said, therefore, he who supplies the Spirit to you and works miracles among you, does he do it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith, which means
righteousness by faith.
Hearing what Jesus did.
Amen.
So the activity that we're all looking for the actions and activity of the Holy Spirit, this is the only place I've ever found in Scripture where Paul directs how that's going to happen. So instead of, sometimes we can seek for manifestations or we can seek to know more about Jesus, and the Spirit who's operating in our midst will begin to do these things as we talk about his Son. Isn't that amazing that he said he's asking this question? And what's in the early, he asked two questions here. You started off in the Spirit, do you think you're going to get better in the flesh? That's the first question. The second one, the Holy Spirit that's doing all these things in your midst, do you think he's doing it because of how good you perform and how good you are and how well you live? He's saying it's by the hearing of faith.
Amen.
Hearing about what Jesus did. Now here, look at this. In your notes there it says, just as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Therefore know that only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. Only those who are of what Jesus did, what he performed. Now, the question in your notes is, what did Abraham believe? Well, the answer is in the next couple of verses there. What did Abraham believe? He believed the gospel. It says right there in the scripture, verse 8, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by what Jesus did.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Trying to get you programmed. Faith
right.
is what Jesus did.
Amen.
So when you read these scriptures, read it in that light. It says that would justify the Gentiles because of what Jesus did. Preach the gospel to Abraham. Right there, Paul said he had the gospel preached to him.
Amen.
Beforehand, and here's the gospel, saying, in you all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. Now that doesn't mean because of Abraham as a man. It's because of the seed. And he goes on to say, verse 16, it says, now to Abraham and his capital S seed were the promises made. He does not say into seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed who is Christ. So what Abraham believed is the same thing we believe, that his blessing was coming through Jesus, that was coming through him. That was the seed, and that was the gospel, the same gospel we believe. Our blessing is because of Jesus. Abraham believed the same thing, that his blessing was coming through the seed, Christ. And he actually had him do the illustrated sermon. He had him take his son up on the mountain. I'm telling you, this is the honest truth. I know he can go to Israel, but Abraham put his son, Isaac, you could put an X on the ground where the cross was eventually going to be. And that's where Abraham laid his son on that wood. Because it was an illustrated sermon showing him that seed that was coming through him was going to be the lamb that God would provide for himself. But remember, Isaac was laying there and said, Dad, this is all good, but where's the offering?
Yeah.
And of course, up to that point, Abraham said, well, I'm sorry, but it's you. Sorry. But see, that's how God was illustrating. God was taking the part of Abraham, and his son was taking the part of Isaac. That was an illustrated sermon of the crucifixion. And it was on the same spot. It's Mount Moriah. Because it says Abraham saw it afar off. He saw the place. And I believe he saw where the cross was going to be. And so he believed, and that's what I want us to understand, is that Abraham believed the same thing. And it was accounted to him as righteousness the same way our belief in it, and that seed that came through Abraham. And that's why we're all blessed, not because Abraham just had this blessing with him. And he did bless the natural descendants of Abraham as well. But that's not what he's trying to show here. He's saying it's the faith of Abraham, the righteousness of faith, that causes true blessing. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, let's just read this together in the last section of your notes there. Hebrews 11:1, and I want you to read this differently this morning. And then 12:2. If you want to flip over there, if you have a marker, you may want to underline that. Okay, after a while I quit putting so many blanks in there. But Hebrews chapter 11 verse 1 says, now faith,
what Jesus did,
is the substance, isn't it?
It is.
Now it says, if you have the New King James in the open Bible, it has a reference toward the original language from the word substance. What does it say in your Bible?
Realization.
The realization. So now faith. Now what Jesus did is the realizations of the realization of things hoped for. See, if we're hoping, it's because of a realization that Jesus acquired it for us, right? That's the answer to our hope, is realizing it's all about Him. It's all about what He did. That's the anchor behind the veil that brings us into all the promises. All the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ. In Christ. So that's a little different. And then I added the other word, the evidence of things not seen, but in the original language it's more the... What is the word in your note? It's in your notes. The confidence of things not seen. We're not looking for evidence. He's really wanting us to be confident about it because Jesus is the one that did it. Right?
In one of the translations that I was reading this in, it referred you back to the root word, and that is, I can't pronounce it, E-L-E-G-C-H-O. It says, to be convinced with compelling evidence.
Yeah. And see, who gives us the compelling evidence? The Holy Spirit in us.
Amen.
As we hear about Jesus, the Holy Spirit is witnessing in us. He's witnessing to us. To us, it says in Hebrews 10:12, He's witnessing to us. And then in Romans 8, He's witnessing in us because He now lives in us. But He's saying the same thing. It's about what Jesus accomplished. So when you read that, that stands so much more. It's not a striving on our part anymore. Now, what Jesus did is it's a realization of what He did. And He's the one that causes that confidence to rise up in us. Right. And it's the confidence of the Holy Spirit bearing witness to what Jesus accomplished that increases our faith. Right? It's not me trying to, I can do this. You know, I'm healed. If I say it 25,000 times in the next one day, then I can make it happen because I believe it's going to happen. Do we believe that we're healed because we believe we're healed, or do we believe we're healed because Jesus bore our sicknesses on
Him?
Amen.
See, the word of faith always taught us that it was, if you believe it, you can, you know, the Cadillac or whatever you want, you just say it enough and it'll happen. Well, I'm not saying Cadillacs won't happen, but they're going to happen because Jesus is the source of the blessing, right?
Amen.
Not my saying, I have a Cadillac. You know, that's divination, really.
I mean, it is. That's what I'm going to say. It's like casting a spell.
Yeah, it is. It's not, and so that's why the word of faith has been harmful, because there's so many people that have tried to use being told it had to be your faith if you're going to have anything. If you don't have anything, well, I'm sorry. Yeah, you didn't. Now look what I have, and it's because of my faith.
Uh-huh.
See, that's been the fallacy of what's caused so much corruption in the body. There's not anything. Nothing is impossible. Deborah is saying nothing's impossible when the confidence is in the blessing is going to come from Him. That's why we don't. You know, well, I'm not going to go there, but there's a lot of things we don't do because I don't want people thinking it's their source of why they're going to be blessed.
Right.
Anyway, I'll just leave that late right there. But looking at chapter 12, verse 2, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. It's all about what Jesus, when did this first start with Jesus? What, this plan? The foundation of the world, right? Yeah. So this was already in place Jesus was the one that was going to, and he authors that in our heart. He wants us to simply look unto him. It's yes.
I was going to say there's another verse that kind of Jesus comments on the same thing when the disciples ask him of John.
Yeah.
In John chapter 6:28, they say to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?"
Yeah.
And then Jesus answers and says, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him."
Amen. Perfect, perfect. In fact, I'm going to put that by Galatians as a reference, because that's a really awesome reference to that.
Amen.
For those, what verse is that? John 6:29. That, compare that with what we said about in Galatians. It's the same thing. It's about to believe in him. That's the simplicity of the gospel, and I think he wants our faith to grow, but not our faith in our faith, our faith in him and what he's done and what he wants to freely give us. If God did not spare his own son but delivered him up for us all, how will he not with him freely give us all things?
Amen.
Not because you get to pay for it, but because he got to pay for it.
Yeah.
I think what it boils down to, when I see in my own life now, is, faith works by love.
Absolutely.
Of course, we butchered that in the word of faith and said your faith will work only if you walk in love.
Right.
That means you're earning.
Right. Right.
Whatever faith is supposedly providing for you, you're earning it by your love walk.
Right.
Us better than there, no one else. How misfortune that was.
Yeah.
Walk in love. My faith is good. And then it's become very selfish, really. It's a selfish message.
It's
all about me and my faith. So, amen. Do I really love you? Anyway, because it's all about me.
Exactly.
But no,
corrupts everything. Yeah.
Faith works by love. So, what I've seen, being whatever I need to, manifest in my life, however you want to say that, whatever need I have that I see, is going to come really by further revelation of his love for me.
Absolutely.
And that's why it's not so much sort of struggling to believe or like trying to believe hard enough and all that. That still smells the word of faith, maybe, but it's really just it's a confidence that's being forged in me, if you will, for lack of a better way to say it, but a confidence in me, persuasion in me that he's producing in me of his love for me. And
absolutely.
He will not let me go without this, that, he's a good father. He loves his children. So it's just he wants, that's where he wants me to put my belief, my confidence, my trust is in his goodness and in love. That he's like, I'm not going to let you go without this. Don't you? I think that's where maybe sometimes he allows things to continue in our life. So because ultimately he wants us to know how much he loves us.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? It's not that he wants things to continue, because we all have struggle with issues and challenges in our life. But I think that ultimately, he works all things together for our good. And he wants us to come to that place where we are so confident in his love for us that we wouldn't even question that he would, not be able to perform that or produce that in our life.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a good. That's really good.
It is good.
Good point. So basically today, it's for us to understand that this faith is an imparted thing. It's a spiritual thing that has to be. It's not discerned. It's not learned. It's not reasoned. We try to reason faith, and it's not. It's given to you by the Holy Spirit. This book about two worlds. There are two worlds. We're born into both of them. When you're born again, the Holy Spirit moves in and gives you that witness to truth. Jesus was standing in front of Pontius Pilate, and Pilate, he said, Pilate asked, "Well, what is truth?" Well, it should have been, "Who is truth?" Because he was standing right in front of him, and he didn't see it because he's trying to reason. What is this all? What is what's going on here? You can't reason what was happening. It had to be spiritually discerned, and he didn't understand it. The just, those that have been declared righteous, shall live by what Jesus did.
Amen.
Amen. It's all about what he accomplished.
Amen.
And so we're going to go on and we'll proceed with this. But y'all have your books, and if you would start looking at that, the incorruptible seed will bless you, because there's an anchor for you. That this can't, what you have cannot be changed.
Amen.
This righteousness that you didn't earn, that was given to you, can't be taken away.
Amen.
It's yours forever.
Amen.
And so that incorruptible seed, that union by the Holy Spirit birthing you into the body of Christ, can never be corrupted. So we'll read that chapter about the incorruptible seed, and then we'll get together. We'll have a picnic next week, and then we'll be back here. And then December 2nd is when Jeremiah will be here. So if you don't have the list, is back there, or if you're watching online and you need to find out what the schedule is, it's been posted several times.